Protect Denise George, please.
So, looking back at all the years and all the hurricanes that have happened in Houston and the natural disasters that happen all in the rest of the U.S., such as extraordinarily high winds across the Midwest, natural disasters like this is why I take as much time as necessary to prepare myself for these natural disaster scenarios. The most important tool in my toolbox is my backup solar bank. The backup solar bank is portable backup energy that is downright essential in an emergency. It's the single most convenient way to charge my phone or other electronic devices from virtually anywhere. It's basically a portable charger that fits in my pocket, but unlike typical power banks, it's entirely solar powered, so I never worry about outlets, wires, or batteries. Because this backup solar bank is powered by the sun, I can charge it from virtually anywhere at any time. It also supports wireless charging. So I just lay my phone on top of my backup solar bank and it'll charge my phone wirelessly. In celebration of the holiday season, this little baby is actually on sale. Click the link in my description below to place an order today. In the times that we're living in, you never know when we're gonna need this.
Muchachos y muchachas. So the last that we know about the whole Epstein saga, Epstein supposedly killed himself, and then there's other voices saying that he's still alive, and then Ghislaine Maxwell apparently is being detained. And while we don't know a lot or conclusively about those situations, what we do know is there is still some ongoing activity surrounding the Epstein saga. By an interesting turn of events, Denise George, she's serving as the Attorney General for the U.S. Virgin Islands. She has a background in radio, television, and film, and got her Juris Doctorates later at Howard University. So the last that we had known about Denise George was last year when she first came on the scene. She was known as one of these aggressive lawyers from the Virgin Islands, and initially she was questioning the transactions of Jeffrey Epstein. Well, that has some developments because now she is naming names. The transaction questioning intensified on February 10th when Denise George filed extra paperwork, documentation that named two people from Long Island, Richard Kahn, an accountant from Watermill, and Darren Indyke, an attorney from Glen Cove. Amongst the many other actions that enabled and paved way for Jeffrey Epstein to horrifically take advantage of children and women in his monstrous sex trafficking scheme, these two men are being named as the captains of Epstein's enterprise. As Denise George put it, indispensable captains. In the documentation filing, Denise George alleges Indyke and Kahn participated with Epstein in coercing his sex trafficking victims in at least three cases to enter into arranged and forced marriages in order to obtain immigration status for the foreign women so that they could continue to be available to Epstein for his abuse, a doubly deep assault on their will and dignity. The victims understood that there would be consequences, including serious reputational and bodily harm, if they refused to enter in a marriage or attempted to end it. In each instance, Indyke and Kahn knowingly facilitated the fraudulent and coerced marriages, performing and securing the legal and accounting work involved. Richard Kahn's ties to Jeffrey Epstein dates back several years. Richard Kahn, the accountant, was listed as treasurer of the COUQ Foundation dating back to 2009 and as president of Gratitude America since 2015. Tax records show Kahn and his wife, Lisa, who also owns an apartment in Manhattan's Upper East Side, purchased their Watermill home for $1.5 million in 2016, property records show. And Darren Indyke, the lawyer, reportedly worked for Jeffrey Epstein for more than 20 years. In Denise George's new claims, she also alleges that the pair, Kahn and Indyke directed, approved, enabled, and justified millions of dollars in payments that fueled the Epstein Enterprise's sex trafficking, including payments to women who were forced to have sex with Epstein and or recruited others to be victimized. And get this, this is an incredible development because just last year, last summer, she was just questioning the transactions, but now she has a specific breakdown. In the claims, it alleges, Indyke and Kahn obtained a large and frequent stocks of cash for Epstein, which, based on public knowledge, would have funded Epstein's cash payments for massages coded for forced sex. For instance, about $12,000 per month for 8 months was withdrawn in 97 $1,000 increments from the Epstein account at an ATM. That is a short walk from Indyke's law office from June 2018 to February 2019, the suit alleged. Euros for safe was the notation in some of the 11 checks totaling $126,000 that Indyke wrote from that same account. And in some cases, he made large cash withdrawals, such as cashing a check for $100,000 in 2018, according to investigators. Payments from this account, for which Indyke had signatory authority totaling over $2,500,000, were made to dozens of women with Eastern European surnames, purportedly for hotel expenses, tuition, and rent, and to, again, the immigration lawyer in New York who was involved in one or more forced marriages arranged among Epstein's victims to secure victims' immigration status, authorities added. So, apparently, even more came out of this investigation, not just the transactions, but also the logistics. According to her lawsuit, Epstein kept a harem of abused and trafficked girls as young as 11 years old. So many girls that Jeffrey Epstein actually needed a database to keep track of all of them. In her lawsuit, she states, Epstein used his wealth and power to create the Epstein Enterprise, which engaged in a pattern of criminal activity in the Virgin Islands by repeatedly procuring and subjecting underage girls and young women to unlawful sexual conduct, sex trafficking, and forced labor. This complaint describes intentional conduct so egregious, persistent, and injurious that it shocks the conscious and offends a civilized society. In her lawsuit, it also says the Epstein Enterprise kept a computerized list of underage girls who were in or proximity of the Virgin Islands and able to be transported to Epstein's residence at Little St. James in the Virgin Islands. The Epstein Enterprise used the term work as a code for sexual abuse and upon information and belief reportedly kept computer records of the contact information of the victims. So something to note is that Jeffrey Epstein, when he was under his criminal probe in Manhattan, the abuse claims went up to 2005. Now, Denise George, now that she has filed her claims, her allegations, this is expanding that timeline up to 14 years. It says, as recent as 2018, air traffic controllers and other airport personnel reported seeing Epstein leave his plane with young girls, some of whom appear to be between the age of 11 and 18 years of age. According to the New York Post, the suit argues Epstein ran a decades-long sex trafficking scheme from his private Caribbean estates where minors were lured and recruited to travel by helicopter, plane, and boat to the islands under fraudulent promises and were then raped and abused by Epstein and his associates. The lawsuit detailed a harrowing account of a 15-year-old victim who was so desperate to escape the Epstein's abuse that she tried to swim off the island after she was forced into sex acts with Epstein and his co-conspirators. Epstein and others organized a search party that located her, the girl who tried to swim off the island, and kept her captive by, among other things, confiscating her passport. And of course, by a way of coercion, Epstein, the way that he would attract the young girls is that he would promise them contracts and modeling jobs, you know, everything of the sort. Either that, or he told the young girls that they would be paid a lot of money to just give him massages. Want some more sauce? According to this lawsuit, Jeffrey Epstein transferred a significant amount of assets into a trust 2 days before he died. In the New York Post, it claims that Caribbean locale claims the transfer of those assets beyond the jurisdiction of the probate court were fraudulent. They are seeking the forfeiture of both of the islands and could disperse Epstein's remaining $577 million in assets to girls and women he abused in the region. As if this update didn't already paint a more egregious picture of Epstein and his enablers, the two mentioned, Richard Kahn and Darren Indyke, the financiers of Epstein, forced his victims into arranged marriages. According to Item 73, Denise George alleges in her lawsuit that Epstein preferred girls or women that didn't speak much English to none because they spoke less. Just to give you an idea of the logistics, one of his victims claims that Epstein flew her from New York to Palm Beach to his little St. James Island dozens of times between 2004 and 2017. This very victim, according to the lawsuit, it states during the latter part of this period, she was forced into an arranged marriage to another victim that was facilitated by the defendant slash co-executor Indyke to prevent the other victim from being deported. Allegedly, Epstein forced three female American victims into marriage with foreign victims and using threats and bodily harm if they did not agree to the marriages. Now, I can only imagine that if these were girls that they were interested in, then they probably, and I don't know this for sure, but it sounds like they forced them into lesbianic marriages, one in which they did not want. On line 75, it alleges the Epstein Enterprise transported, held, sexually abused, trafficked, and concealed women and children at his property in the Virgin Islands dozens of times over nearly two decades. But wrapping it up with the point, the named men, Indyke and Kahn, it states, in each instance, Indyke and Kahn knowingly facilitated the fraudulent and coerced marriages, performing and securing legal and accounting work involved, enabling a fraud that would further bind Epstein's victims to him and enable Epstein to continue to control and abuse these victims sexually. It's very interesting that that was one of the most observable traits that Epstein and his, you know, entourage looked out for, the girls and women who didn't speak much English, because his pal, Jean-Luc Brunel, did the same thing when he was scouting for models or for victims, in other words. In a statement, Denise George said, "We cannot go back in time, but we do need your help to see that justice is done now. We have a fresh chance." So it looks to be that things are still getting spicy, regardless of what we think of what happened to Epstein or what's going on with Ghislaine. There is still a lot of activity that's happening in the Epstein saga, and we could only pray and hope that more comes out. There are many high profile and interesting characters that I think we would love to see come to justice. So guys, what do you think about all of these new surfacing claims, allegations, and details? I will continue to keep tabs on this. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. Be sure to like and subscribe, and also follow my Rumble. You're gonna wanna follow my Rumble in the upcoming weeks. You're going to want to follow my Rumble in the upcoming weeks. And hey guys, thank you so much for supporting this channel, supporting me personally. For everybody who feels led by their heart to give, it puts food on my table, keeps a roof over my head, and even puts food in Beau's plate too. So thank you for that. If you feel led to, please go to nataliedenise.com/donate, or there are other fun links in the bottom description below. Thank you guys so much again. I will catch you in the next video.